since in the all the characters in the first game were speaking in sort of overdone French accents.
French accents, yeah.
And I double checked my review, my old review of the game, and indeed I mentioned that. I compared it to all the overdone Italian accents in Assassin's Creed 2.
Oh, in AC2, yeah, yeah.
And I didn't remember that at all. Because, of course, they don't have accents in this game. At least they have British accents, which, to my mind, is not having an accent.
Yeah, and to me, like, the British accent is for, like, dumb Americans. Like, I just give anyone a British accent, they're just going to sound European. That's fine.
British is the history accent. People in history, yeah. All the people of history had British accents.
Even that's fake history. Game of Thrones history, everyone's got a British accent.
That's the American attitude.
Yeah.
Well, Game of Thrones is very... you know, obviously based on the American attitude, the War of the Roses, which was a significant conflict in British history, and the whole like culture of Westeros is based on medieval England, so I would say it's fair enough to give everyone in Game of Thrones British accents.
Do you guys got ice zombies up there, like up in the north?
Yeah, we call them Glaswegians.
Oh, sick burn if there's any Glaswegians in the audience.
Ha ha. Okay, welcome to the Post-CP stream, everyone. I'm Yahtzee Crucial. I'm joined by Marty Sleaver.
Hello, everyone.
Who's joining me, because he's also finished this game.
I have. I enjoyed it. How about you?
I didn't like it very much at all.
Uh-oh.
But for me, that's mainly because of story. I'm very story-focused when I review games.
You are, yes. Well, and this game is very story-focused, so it's understandable to me. Very critical of its story.
The gameplay just felt sort of generically functional. I'll admit it's quite a visually spectacular game, but that's never that's never been a huge sell to me.
Yeah, we were talking about like how it's probably one of the best looking games I've played, but at this point, like, is that enough? And I don't think it is. I don't think visuals alone can sell a game. However, I did I really liked the story. I was really invested in Hugo and Amicia's journey. And B, I thought the combat sort of became much more interesting in the same way that I thought the combat in The Last of Us Part 2 was more interesting than in the original game.
I was the opposite of invested in Amicia and Hugo's journey. I think the journey should have fucking stopped. I think that would have probably helped in a lot of ways.
Do you think this game suffered from... I do think the game was a little long in the tooth, which I think of... almost every game, including The Last of Us Part 2. Do you think the game was just too long, or just were you... I know you mentioned before how you, at a certain point, you stopped kind of empathizing with them because you were like, you are creating terrible situations everywhere you go. Why are you doing this?
Yeah, pretty much. Hang on, I'm just turning your volume up a bit. Say things.
Hello, we're talking about the video game again. Also, thank you so much, Aptem, welcome to Early Access, and Carl... also, welcome to Early Access. And E1 Craze for Life, thank you so much for the $5 donation. Would you ever want your kids to take a similar interest in video games as you, Yahtzee?
Well, obviously, yeah. Because I really like video games and believe in them as an art form. And I'd love to be able to teach my children my ways.
Yeah, we discussed that a little bit in Monday's Slate Something Else when we were talking about... like Mario Odyssey and how you've been playing that sort of alongside your kids and where we thought a good place to start your kids off with games would be. I think Jack agreed with you that he thought Mario Odyssey would be a very confusing place to start off kids with games.
Because of the 3D platforming thing?
Yeah. Just there's like a lot going on. And so, yeah, I don't know if always starting off 2D might be the way, like learn to crawl before you walk.
Yeah, I'd say so. Start on, like, Mario 3 or something.
Yeah.
Or New Super Mario Brothers.
Folks in chat are saying it's running at, like, 15 frames per second. Is that,
I'm not seeing any issues on my stream.
It definitely looks like it's running at, like, 15 frames per second on what you're sharing with me.
Huh.
Oh, but I think that's the entire thing. Marty's cam seems to be framey as well. Maybe it's because you're sharing the thing. Maybe if you don't share it.
Okay, let me try not sharing it.
All right, see, let this be a lesson to everyone. Don't share things.
Oh, blimey.
Jaheim Crusell with a very topical comment that says Sifu is overrated. Did anyone mention anything about Sifu? Did anyone even say Sifu?
No, I think he just needed to transmit his hot take.
Also, no one's still talking about Sifu. It's not overrated. It just is. Let Sifu be. Oh, now it's good. There you go. You fixed it. You saved Christmas.
Oh, hang on. Does that look fine?
That would be a chat question because I'm now watching the stream. Chat, does this look fine?
Still dropping. Yeah, because when I look at it when I switch to my streaming software to XSplit, then it looks smooth. Like the animation at the moment is smooth.
I think someone was saying that this game has been notorious that it's had problems streaming.
Huh. Yeah, I think it might be the game's fault.
It says we're getting a very low bit rate on Restream.
Because when I look, because you can see like the animation of the floating leaves in the background now, right? And it looks smooth. But when I switch to the game, it goes choppy again.
Truly a mystery.
Yeah, it looks choppy in my streaming software.
Are you playing the game at like a crazy high resolution that doesn't need to be that high?
That's 1080p.
That was one thing for me. The game, okay. Because when I started, the game defaulted to like a weirdly high reso that I didn't need.
They're saying there's like common performance problems. All right, let's mess with some settings.
Settings. Nick says two things. I would make sure to be playing in full screen and turn off motion blur.
Okay. Motion blur. No. Has that helped? Not really, by the looks of the things.
Amjin just says it's because the game is just too tragic and powerfully emotional to be streamed. Agreed. Maelstrom says Yahtzee needs more internet. No, Yahtzee just said he just got fiber.
Yeah, it's not the internet. It's the game. Yeah. People keep... Yeah.
Nick says you're in windowed, so try switching to full screen.
Yeah, I switched to full screen. That doesn't seem to have helped. So it's a full screen now. And it's still... choppy as all get out.
People are saying I think my camera is also choppy, which
yeah, my camera is choppy too. Hang on,
Samjin just said looks good now.
Well,
I guess get out of the menus. Like now, it looks good on the stream.
Wait, it looks good on the stream.
Oh, that's what Nick said. Nah, it looks good now on stream.
Does it? In full screen mode?
That's what they said. Definitely keep it in full screen. Look smooth. If we're choppy, we being choppy, that's not a big deal if we're choppy. I think if the game's working fine.
It's still, like, the whole game and our cameras look choppy when I look in my streaming software. Is it not choppy on the stream?
Well, run around. Like, do things. Because right now, I think you're just moving the camera around.
Here I am enjoying this massively overbloomed French countryside.
I think it looks fine on the stream.
Hang on, I need to see for myself.
Links. Oh no, everyone's saying choppy now. 20-30 frames.
20-30 frames.
Well, that's an upgrade from 10 frames. I mean, 30 frames would be nice. 30, like that Gotham Knights is just 30 frames.
Hang on, I'm gonna look at the stream myself.
I mean, yeah, maybe drop it to 720p. No one's watching this in HD. They're fine. 480i is fine.
Oh, yeah. It looks slightly smoother on stream now that I'm looking at it. Okay, well, I guess we'll just live with this frame rate. How about that? Is that okay with everyone?
Yeah, new donation goal. You have to tell us if it's okay or not. Nick said only other things I can think of is to make sure VSync is off and turn off DLSS.
I always find VSync causes more trouble than it's worth.
Fucking VSync.
DLSS off. Motion blur, no. What was the other one? VSync?
VSync off, DLSS off.
I'm not seeing a VSync option.
Well, White Dwarf, yeah, the game was working fine for all of us when we weren't streaming it. Streaming games a lot of times can cause a lot of little fuck-ups.
Oh, they didn't call it VSync, they called it vertical synchronization. That's why I
missed
it.
Oh, what fancies.
But it's already turned off by the looks of things.
Fat Highlander with a $5 donation. Thank you so much, Highlander. Says, game quality doesn't matter. Host quality matters.
Of course
it
does.
Well, then we're really screwed. Because that's not great either.
Okay. It's a little choppy, but you're going to have to live with it.
They've seen worse. It's fine. Let's go see. Oh, Nick said, looks good now, Yahtzee.
Oh, okay.
Andrew Kamenov said Marty getting more ammunition in his anti-PC crusade. This is true.
I'm getting more ammunition for my anti-this game crusade.
Ah, waka waka. So what was it about? So to me, these characters and this story was actually pretty affecting. I really liked the relationship between Hugo and Amicia. I thought the performances were really good. I thought the writing was really good. I liked the sort of ebb and flow of them finding small bits of happiness before having the rug pulled out from under them.
What you call ebb and flow, I call repetitiveness. It's like this game goes through that whole cycle like 4 times. Oh, we've reached a new happy place. Everything's fine. Things can finally be good. We finally found our home. And internally I'm going, these people are fucked. Everyone's dead. And sure enough, within a couple of chapters, oh, we didn't realize there was this entire plague-stricken city around the corner. We didn't notice.
But isn't that a basis for a lot of storytelling? Like, isn't that, like, horror movies are, like, you find, like, a moment of reprieve before things get even worse. Like, I don't think...
It feels like none of the characters learned anything. I don't understand the main character's devotion to this kid who causes all these disasters and making everyone die.
It's her brother. It's like, why would she?
You say that like it's supposed to mean something. Like
it's a thousand, I mean, yeah, it's a loved one.
Thousands upon thousands of people die in this game, and they don't really have any real solution for how to fix the fact that he keeps murdering everyone.
I mean, at what point would you stop to save a loved one? Would you be like, all right, well, you just gotta die because all these strangers have to live?
Well, it's
like,
not just
a very realistic element.
It's not just saving a loved one. We seem to be hyper-fixated on not allowing him to feel even the slightest moment of sadness. Like, he was moaning a bit because his, like, medical procedure hurt, so we then had to fucking risk our lives over and over again to get him some pain-killing medicine. Literally murder an entire platoon of men in order to stop them preventing us from getting the painkilling medicine back to him.
Would you not murder an entire platoon of men if one of your kids was sick?
No, because that would be mental.
Okay.
I would trust that the medical professionals knew more about this than I did.
Nasad said, he's her brother, versus why does she love him is such a funny impasse. I think it is an impasse. Honestly, that's what I think
it is. I suppose it is, yes. Yeah. I suppose you're never going to be able to explain this to me.
No. I, like, it, you have kids. Like, isn't that, like, inherent in that? Like, wouldn't you do anything to save your kids?
I wouldn't murder 10,000 other people. At that point, I would think maybe, you know, that isn't worth the candle.
Well, that's I do think that's just a narrative impasse at that point. Well, okay, so if that's more of like a macro thing on a micro level, like what did you think of the individual like interactions? So like taken apart from the whole, did you think the game had good writing performances? Were those even like, could you not just not get past the?
I just hated the way everyone constantly whispered at each other because I hate the sound.
Let the rats hear them.
I hate the sound of whispering in my ears. It gives me misophonia.
You can't. I mean, they shouldn't be loud. There's bad people all around.
Also, I kind of got kind of sick of the constant urgent voice. I was kind of sick of it in the Tomb Raider reboots. I'm even more sick of it now.
What do you mean by constant urgent voice?
The constant urgent voice. We must do this. We must save the day. We must get to this next place. We've got no choice.
So aside from financial domination, I feel like you might have a future in ASMR.
I can never listen to that sort of thing because of my misophonia. I hate listening back to myself if I feel like I'm breathing too loudly into the mic.
Well, there you go. You can create it. You don't have to consume it. It's fine. Tommy Salty with 25 Zwoti, thank you so much, Tommy, says, I would like to commend people on the hard work on the animations and art for Adventurous Nye's side quest, and Nick for his troubleshooting skills, and Marty, because. Thank you so much, Tommy, and thank you for all of your contributions to the various Adventurous Nye's. Incredible music. Mr. Valentine with a $5 dono, thank you so much, says, Yahtzee, what frustrated you more, the hand-holding puzzle design or America's complete inability to learn anything at all? Oh, Amicia's, not America's. I think that was a Freudian slip on my part. Amicia's complete inability to learn anything at all.
Well, I guess we've established it's the characters that's my main issue.
Yeah.
God damn it, I'm so sick of this bloody stealth tutorial. Let's just bean this twat in the head and move on. So I will say, Lucas is the fucking unsung hero of this game. He puts up with so much shit.
He does put up with a lot of shit. And then he bounces for a
He just bounces in the epilogue. I wanted to know where the fuck what the fuck he was up to.
Yeah. Fair enough. I liked that along this journey, it feels like there's these... it does go through that exact...
I feel like there's a lot of moments in this game where the main characters make stupid or poor decisions which unnecessarily draws the game out. Like when they're going on the boat down the river... And Amicia gets off the boat to push it out of some debris. And somehow it never occurs to her that maybe she should get a wriggle on in terms of getting back in the boat.
Because when the boat is free, it's going to start going down the river quickly?
Yeah. And there was one like moment that gave me a dark moment of laughter where the same chapter where you're trying to get back in the boat and you see it in the distance and the main character goes, how are we going to get back to it? Because clearly you have to go through like this whole rat rearrangement puzzle to get to it. But at the time she was saying this, she was standing in front of like a single rope that was blocking her way. A single waist-high rope to mark the invisible wall, which any sane person could have very easily stepped over. It just made me laugh that they chose that particular visual shorthand for the invisible wall at that moment. Where are we going? I wasn't paying attention.
Where are we going with the in the prologue?
I guess we go towards that castle, don't we?
I think we go towards the castle. But don't worry, everything's fine now, and nothing will go wrong. Because if there's one thing this game has, it's just really
every
nice
time,
moments where
every
nothing
time,
goes wrong.
Like shit gets real, it always feels really contrived. Like for some reason, we have really bad luck into running into people who leap to deadly violence as the first solution to anything. Their response to feeling slightly confused by the presence of strange kids is always immediate murder.
I mean, isn't that just the setting of the game, though? Is like this thing, this plague has been tearing the country apart.
People talk a lot of shit about medieval people. I don't think it's reasonable at all for any person to immediately start murdering kids from any historical setting, because that's a biological imperative, isn't it, to protect kids?
I mean, well, not if you have to kill 10,000 people, apparently. I mean, it's the setting of the game. This is a fantasy game. This doesn't need to be historically accurate. Like, this is a world that's been forever impacted by this plague.
Why aren't they all wearing wizard costumes then? In that case, it's historically accurate to us to an extent. And anyway, I'm not talking about historical accuracy. I'm talking about verisimilitude.
I mean, characters in a thing don't have to act like, I don't know. I don't think characters in a work of fiction have to act exactly like people in real life. Maybe that's a weird take.
I feel like they need to act in a way that rings true. That's what I mean by verisimilitude.
Yeah, to me it rang true in the fiction of the world. Like, I don't think it has to ring true in our world. Because in our world, people aren't... Well, we are dealing with an ongoing plague, I guess. We don't have waves of rats tearing through France in our world and people having to pick up the pieces and figure out what the hell's going on with this. Dialetic Coma says they have to follow an internal logic. I think the game has an internal logic.
Yeah. Everyone always inexplicably tries to kill us. And we keep taking our pet apocalypse to densely populated areas for some reason.
Pet apocalypse, who is your brother? I don't... this is weird that, like... is there a line that, like... is there a certain number of people you would kill for a family member, but then, like...
Dude,
anything more than that isn't worth it?
If my wife came home and said, I murdered 100 people today, I'd call the police. I'd be afraid she'd murder me.
But what if it was for you? Murdered them for you.
That's somehow even worse, because now I'm supposed to feel guilty about it.
Shulky, with the 10 euro donation, thank you so much. Said relatively sober donation compared to my last ones, but I'm trying to optimize my PC setup right now. But love you guys and can't wait for Adventures Nigh Live. You all deserve the experience.
This is the Last of Us again. Has everyone else got different brains to me? And that's why they think that game's game of the year, and I think it's a depressing mess.
I think you have different brains to everyone else. Yes, but no, it's not. I think there's a pretty decent contingency of people who didn't like The Last of Us. Jack very much did not like The Last of Us.
Do I have to break?
You mentioning The Last of Us, I think, is pretty spot on. I think that's like a...
This is a very Last of Us-y game.
Yeah, even more so.
This game left me cold in the same way The Last of Us left me cold.
Yeah.
I know to a certain extent we're supposed to... You know, think these characters are like in a horrific situation, and we're not necessarily supposed to agree with their actions.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not so much agreeing with their actions as not understanding their motivation.
I mean, I just think it's a very simple motivation of I will do anything to save my loved ones, which is what the motivation of The Last of Us is.
Why does Amicia leap to the conclusion she has to go to the island about which all she knows is that Hugo dreams about it? Why is that only solution she's willing to, like, entertain?
Because they spent a game and a half of trying other solutions and nothing has worked, and so ultimately it's hope. It's the power of hope, right?
But she's, like, throwing away all the other solutions. They bring her to the dude who, like, gives medical treatment, and she just wants to get him away from him first chance she gets. Just because she thinks he's a bit of an asshole.
Well, without spoiling it, the medical things he's trying to do aren't ultimately in, you know, it's not in service of Hugo's best interest.
She doesn't know they won't work, though.
Yeah, but she spent, again, a game and a half of people using
her
brother.
And this dude has been studying alchemy his whole life. Who's experienced?
Oh, like an alchemist has never been bad. I don't trust any alchemists. Get all these fucking alchemists out of here. I don't trust a single one of them. Also, going back to some super chats. Kamja Ninja with $2, thank you so much, says, A Plague Tale contrivance.
Yeah.
Very good goof. You know, and the Devil's Foot with $5 says, first time donor, can't wait for Adventures Nigh Season 3. Thank you so much for the donation. And as you can see, look at us. Last night we passed 70%. We're almost at 71% now.
Well, we definitely won't get to 75% on this stream.
No.
Like these dudes will do that.
You know who would get to 75%? Amicia, because she would do anything for her brother.
No, she would murder the entire chat. And then wonder aloud why everyone seems to hate her.
Sir George Lucas said, look how not depressing this game is compared to The Last of Us. George Lucas, just wait. This game's very depressing.
Also, why did we sneak into this castle?
This was a bad idea. This castle was just a very bad idea.
We will swiftly learn what a bad idea this was. Mm-hmm. We came in here on a childish whim. We brought our pet Apocalypse here on a childish whim. And now we're surprised that things are going to go wrong.
You know what job takes a lot of stray shots in this game? Beekeepers. I always thought beekeepers were really nice. And the first thing we're going to see in this game, beekeepers, not great.
It seems like you'd have to be pretty easygoing to be a beekeeper.
Yeah, you'd have to like really remain like calm under pressure.
Okay, sting my ass, guys. I guess I asked for it.
Reflexes of Dead Cat says, what about those full metal alchemists, Smarty? That's true. Only good alchemists are the full metal ones.
Is that an authentic medieval beekeeping outfit, I wonder?
Yeah, I don't know. I think I was more, going back to what we said before, I was impressed by how not only how good the game looks, but how like varied the locations are. I thought a lot of the first game looked kind of samey, but I like that this takes you to a lot of different places. There's a lot of moments where things are really nice and colorful for a little while before they get dark and infested with rats.
This incidentally was character who inexplicably turns murderous one of question mark.
That's because he's a beekeeper. Terrible trade. Beekeeper's a trade filled with murderers.
I think these are the only beekeepers we run into just in this prologue, though.
You run into optional nice beekeepers later on. There's one point where there's a very large, you're in a very large sort of village that has like windmills and flowers and stuff, and at one point you can find actual beekeepers. And Hugo gets very scared, but Amicia's like, no, not, hashtag not all beekeepers are murderers.
Well, it seems like this game is pretty even-handed with beekeepers.
There you go. I'm sure there's been a beekeeper murder before, right? But Insus, with a big long message, but I think it's pretty good, says, I have a theory. People like to relate to characters on screen. Some people, myself included, are bad at making a decision or going to action. Reboot Lara Croft is conflicted about the basic gameplay. Last of Us is all about protagonist/story being conflicted of the basic gameplay. And this game has people acting more reactively to circumstances instead of being motivated. Yasu seems to not have that problem, so therefore he might not relate as well. You do seem very decisive as a person.
Well, that's nice of you to say.
Yeah.
But it's...
I think that's a good trade-off.
I feel it's more the sudden danger we keep getting into just doesn't make sense. It just feels contrived that everything keeps ramping up to deadly survival situation instantly.
I don't know. To me, it just felt like the cycle of storytelling. And, you know, I mentioned the ebb and flow earlier, and I kind of like that the game isn't just constant sort of bashing you over the head with, like, bad times. It does sort of weave in these, moments of reprieve and, you know, quiet moments and nice moments and moments where Hugo and Amicia can be kids and go on a swing or play a game at a fair.
Don't let the kid be a kid. He's a pet Apocalypse. Don't do that. That's
very irresponsible.
He's still a kid?
No, he's a kid Apocalypse. He's a kid Apocalypse.
It's very irresponsible to let that kid Apocalypse run ahead and play on the swings. Why would you do that? He needs to be, like, sealed in concrete.
If he could just be a kid, he'd be fine. If he didn't have to deal with these life-ending occasions.
Well, that's a wonderful thought, but as this game demonstrates time and time again, apparently you can't just be a kid, because a random beekeeper will try to kill you with an axe. It's like saying, as like we should be able to leave our front door wide open all night. I mean, don't do that. You'll get burgled. I'm sure it would be an ideal world if we could leave our front door open all night. Maybe, you know, you're right. We should be able to leave our front door open all night. But if you do leave your front door open all night and you get burgled, you don't really have anyone to blame but yourself, in my view.
Also, I feel like the burglar takes like 5% of the blame. I think a little bit of the blame goes to the burglar.
Maybe he's having hard times.
Maybe he needs to burgle to save his little brother from the rat disease.
There you go. Maybe, what if, like, Amicia got killed by, like, a passing 15-year-old girl who needs to kill her to save her 6-year-old brother from the rat apocalypse?
Is that what Amicia and Hugo meeting Joel and Ellie is, like, the unstoppable force meeting the immovable object?
Yeah. Think about that.
Scavenger with a $2 dono says, as a beekeeping alchemist, I feel targeted. Very specific job, Scavenger. Very specific job. Robert Middleton with a £20 donation. Thank you so much, Robert. Says, I love The Last of Us. I was obsessed with it, but after part two, my love kind of died. I've lost interest in the HBO show and can't even play the original game again. Should I let a bad sequel to an ongoing story ruin what I loved about the original?
I think in The Last of Us, there was at least a tone of hope. Except, and then, like, the character makes, like, a very questionable decision right at the end. Last of Us 2 is, like, questionable decisions from start to finish.
Yeah, the first game definitely has much more of an air of hope than The Last of Us 2. But again, that questionable decision is rooted in the exact same place as Amicia's series of questionable decisions in this game. Also, I've said this before, but I don't think something being bad should ruin things you liked beforehand. Like, I talked about a bunch of shows doing a full rewatch of Game of Thrones a couple of months ago, and I don't think the bad last couple seasons ruined how
it's
amazing
good.
The first couple were.
Just stop watching when Charles Dance bites it, would be my
advice.
Stop
watching everything when Charles Dance leaves.
Yeah, unless it's Netflix's Sandman, because he dies pretty soon into that.
It's a very short show for you, then. But same thing, like, the shitty new Star Wars movies don't ruin how great the original Star Wars movies are. For me. Maybe for you. PM Stripolito, subscribed to Tier 1 over on Twitch, been a member for 33 months. Thank you so much, Stripolito said. What is a cocktail you'd recommend for easy sipping while unwinding with video games?
Hard to easy sip when you're holding a controller with both hands.
It is. If it's cold, if we're hitting autumn and winter months for you, I'm a big fan of either hot toddies or Irish coffees, which are just generally whiskey with either, you know, kind of like a black tea and cinnamon, or whiskey with black coffee and a little bit of cream.
Maybe if you're playing like a first-person shooter with mouse and keyboard, keep a rocks glass with a white Russian in it next to your mouse hand. Take a little sip in between gunfights.
What you need is you need one of those hats that have you can put the two beer cans in that have like the little straws going in your mouth. Mm. So there you go. You don't even need to use your hands.
Oh, excuse me.
Scavenger again with $5. Thank you so much, Scavenger. Scavenger makes a lot of money from beekeeping / alchemisting. Alchemying? Alchemying? I wonder if Yahtzee's hatred of this kid is less his being a parent and more his ZP stories of being a sibling.
Well, you might have me there, but I was a younger sibling, so if anything, I would be the Hugo in this scenario. Mm.
When I was playing this game, every time I saw Hugo, I was like, man, that seems like a little Yahtzee right there.
Well, I feel slightly insulted.
He likes feathers, he likes flowers, he kills a lot of people with rats.
I don't feel like you shouldn't have to indulge a 6-year-old's whims when you're in a life or death situation.
You gotta keep him calm. That's what The Road taught me. The hit Cormac McCarthy book.
You know what would be a good way to keep him calm? Just kill him. just pound his head into the concrete. It'll only take a second. Then you can have another 6-year-old brother. Just introduce your mum to someone nice.
You can introduce the mum to... Oh, God. Yeah, there's a bunch of characters you meet that you can introduce the mum to.
Introduce him to that hairy dude in the second act.
Yeah. you go. Cool pirate lady. Yeah, let him adopt a kid. That'd be great.
Wait a few years, get Lucas to father one.
Yeah.
On you. You could have a child if you wait that long.
Me?
No, I
no,
mean,
Amicia.
The main character, Amicia. She could have
could
her very
you
own
imagine
Scotland,
the lengths
who
she'd go to save
cause
her own
a rat
child?
Apocalypse.
Could
well,
you
she wouldn't
imagine,
have
though?
To, because her own child wouldn't cause a rat apocalypse, would she?
Maybe it's in her blood. Maybe it's in her blood. We don't know.
Except she doesn't have, like, rat apocalypse powers. And it's established in the plot that only one rat whisperer is born every, like, 600 years. So, yeah, people say whispers. I wasn't paying attention. Fuck you.
I never said you weren't paying attention.
That fucking really long comment that appeared, like, 10 minutes after the video went up on the Escapist site this morning. That said,
oh,
I didn't
great.
Pay attention. I took that personally. Are you with the thieves?
No, we just arrived. That I always hate the only reason you didn't like it is because you didn't understand it or you weren't paying attention. It's like, no, I could just
fucking
not like a thing.
I hate that kind of feedback. That's
yeah.
the shit I always get when I hate on something everyone else likes.
Yeah.
Oh, you just didn't understand. Aloy was born an outcast and shunned by her people. Yeah, I know. I'm not questioning... I was supposed to do something there. I'm not saying she wasn't adequately established to be insufferable. I'm saying mm-hmm. she's insufferable.
The hows and whys don't matter. It's the end result.
There you go.
The man who chopped up his finger with €5, thank you so much, said, out of three games we're discussing, I played only The Last of Us Part 1, and I thought it was really good. Miserable characters in a miserable world, yeah, they react like this. Yeah, I think of The Last of Us 1, The Last of Us 2, and this game, The Last of Us 1 probably has the most universal praise. Not everyone, clearly. The Last of Us 2, I think, was much more of a divisive game.
Divisive?
And
yeah.
Divisive? Divisive?
Mind you, all the killing in Last of Us 2, I mean, it's established to be a post-apocalyptic world, so, you know, might as well go nuts.
Yeah.
This doesn't have that benefit. I mean, this is a mostly not post-apocalyptic world.
I mean, it feels like this is, like, on the verge of an apocalyptic world, right? Like, if the rats are here, then the rats can go anywhere. If they can get all around France and onto islands.
Yeah, it's
a
verge of apocalypse. We are uniquely positioned to be able to prevent the apocalypse. But we never do, when it would be so easy to prevent. Just, you know, aim your little sling a little further to the right and down and bean him on the side of the head. No more apocalypse. We win. Roll credits.
I like how right the beeping him right and down is like the inverse of the Kennedy back and to the left. It's
there
perfect.
You go.
Christian Hess with a $9.99 donation, thank you so much, says, gotta agree with Yachts. Family is family, but at some point you gotta step back and say, yeah, I love you, but you're dangerous and your happiness won't trump the literal ability to live, the literal ability of others to live.
Yeah. It's just, I like to think I'm trying to approach this from a rational perspective.
I feel like once rat plagues get introduced, then rationality goes out the window. Andrew Hickenbottom says he's all for your child murder plan.
Amicia? Okay, so in the plot, we've just triggered the next rat apocalypse because we decided to break into a castle for literally no reason, and the residents were understandably annoyed, and now everyone's going to die because of our decisions, and we are not going to kill this stupid shit. At least not immediately. Spoiler
first
alert.
Off, we wanted to explore the castle because we were playing. I think. Did you not go out playing when you were a kid and go somewhere you shouldn't have went? That's not kind of construction
I used
sites.
I used to play in my back garden. I remember
you
a lot of.
Never ventured outside those garden walls?
I remember a lot of PSAs on TV telling you specifically not to explore construction sites and shit.
Counterpoint, we used to do that a lot. I thought that was great. Sneaking in people's yards. It was great. I never thought that evil beekeepers would try to murder us.
I feel like this game is just a long thread of Amicia taking the stupidest possible option for no particular reason except because it draws the gameplay out.
It's the no particular reason is she doesn't want to kill her brother. Like, that is a major reason. I feel like I'm insane.
Except in the cases where she forgets to get back on the boat as she's pushing it away from the debris in the river.
She's got a lot going on. She's thinking about what upgrades she's going to do soon. Haven't you ever been out and then you've forgotten like certain groceries because you were thinking about what upgrades you're going to get?
I didn't forget to avoid an apocalypse.
You're not thinking about upgrades enough. That's the problem. Devil's Foot with a $10 dono. Thank you so much. It says, guilt tripped donation. Yahtzee, do you have any character from your books that you would call your favorite slash most proud of?
Well, I think the character I've enjoyed writing the most in the last couple of Galaxy for Food books is Inspector Honda, who was a character I introduced in the second book, who's a sort of police detective who affects a sort of lazy, slow of thinking appearance. Although he is secretly a very keen-minded detective.
Ooh,
I just like that sort of character. I'm a big fan of Columbo as well.
We share a deep love for Columbo, so this is true. Nick Grunler, been a member for 16 months. Thank you so much, Nick. Using early access to say, God, the whisper yell hurts my ears at this level. I like the whisper yells. I think it's great. I think it's just a little entryway to ASMR. And Eric Burr with a $4.99 donation. Thank you so much, Eric Burr. Says, prereq, the escapist save Christmas special?
Doubt it.
Could be, who knows? Just, I was about to say keep donating and maybe it'll happen, but no, it won't happen. don't rely on that. However, we are almost at 72%, which is very exciting. I do like that the chat does seem relatively split between correct Yahtzee, kill the kid, and Jesus Yahtzee, it's a kid.
Emotional versus logical thinkers. It's how most of us are split.
And I think the emotional ones make the world probably a bad place, ultimately. But the place we live. And I think it's great.
Emotional voters are the ones who get snared in the QAnon trap.
That's not true.
Prove me wrong, American public.
Oh no. I can't prove you wrong with the American public. I feel like I'm emotional. And I've only got tricked by QAnon on a handful of occasions. Dick Earthquake with a $9.99 donation. Thank you so much, Dick Earthquake. Says, Yahtzee, since we're in your Findome arc, can you give me your best Ubu Baka?
Ubu Baka. There, hope that was worth the money.
That's my favorite Star Wars character. And then there was a big bird that saved me. And the man who chopped off his finger upgraded their membership to bonus content. Thank you so much, man who chopped off.
Nice. Finger. Hopefully this will compensate for your lost finger.
To be fair, I guess the game, I misread the name.
Some reason the game is not choppy in my stream window anymore.
Oh, that's good. We're all exhausted. The name was actually the man who chopped off the finger. So I assumed it was their own finger.
Well, the sex bots knew when some horny action was starting on the screen. yeah, because we're riding with Amicia's sexy mum.
Oh, Beatrice.
I would.
I think her name was Beatrice.
She's a MILF. She's a M-I-L save from a rodent apocalypse. Concerns everybody, and it can change everything.
What's that? I don't know. Be careful. Let's see.
Oh, I see waist-high grass in the distance. Shit's about to go down.
Oh, you know that. When you see like some wheat, you're like, oh man, shit's gonna get dangerous. Exactly. They trespassed on a family's property.
There was an argument and men were slaughtered. The younger brother witnessed it. Well, that's horrible. It wasn't a dream. Oh, I do too. And so this is just really just an escalation of the first fuck up. I don't think this counts as fuck up number two.
Yes. No, this all feels like the preamble fuck up. I think fuck up number two is when you get to the new city. And Eric Burr back with another $4.99 donation. Thanks so much, Eric. Said, selling tickets for live studio audiences. Do we need to buy tickets to Wisconsin? Yes, buy several tickets to Wisconsin. And I don't know, I assume you're goofing. But if you're not goofing, just to make it clear, Adventures Night Season 3 filming on location in Milwaukee. It is not going to be an event for the public. It is us getting together to film Season 3 in a...
Yeah, we just want to knock it all out quick, you know, and get on with our important lives.
like saving your children by murdering 10,000 people.
Yeah.
What is? Would you murder one person for your child?
Well, if the child, if the person was, directly threatening my child, then yes.
Okay. What if a mob of 10,000 were directly threatening your child?
Well, I guess I'd want to know a bit more context.
Okay. Well, you try. Well, they're dead. So that's why you gotta be emotional. Yeah, Amicia kills a lot of people in this game.
Like, right. In that case, only... in this case, I would grab my child and I would run the fuck away. How about that?
Okay. Oh, but here come the rats.
And then I'd expect a very in-depth explanation, young lady.
I'd like a PowerPoint presentation on what the fuck is going on. Scavenger with another $5. Thank you so much. Scavenger said two things. One, I suspect beekeepers were hard asses because they were few things to sweeten / preserve food. It was worth a lot of money in those days. And two, thank you so much for another $5. Yahtzee talking about staying in his yard makes me wonder if he was raised seeing that British PSA ad on TV about power station and electricity safety.
Oh, I saw a couple of those sorts of things. Some of them would get really sort of scare them straight violent. They were sort of trying to deliberately traumatize the kids, so they'd absolutely not go into the construction yard. Like, heads being crushed and, sudden, not quite seamless cut to dummy of child before hideous violence happens.
I was just like, what was the British movie about the nuclear, the nukes being dropped on London?
There were a few of that sort of thing.
One in the 80s?
Sure which specific one they're talking about. Oh, the
one with a T?
Thing.
Starts with a T? Traces. What was it?
Someone will know.
Not a boy and his dog.
I'll know it once I hear it.
Threads.
Threads, that was
Thank
it.
You, Andrew. Come on. Well done, Andrew. The Devil's Foot with a $2 dono. Thank you so much. Said one more vote to offing the little brother. Well, this isn't. We're not going to kill the little brother in this 2 hours. Don't worry. I mean, maybe he'll get killed by, things, but it won't be our fault. And we'll just.
I would say this is a case of this game indulging in really weirdly over the top apocalyptic set piece in disproportionate response to the players, to the main character's actions.
What do you mean?
I mean. All we did was get stopped on a road and run away, and suddenly everything's on fire and houses are collapsing.
That's true. Yes, it did escalate very quickly.
Yeah, it feels a bit absurd the way this game escalates sometimes. I think the mission where you get sent out to get painkilling herbs and it ends with you murdering 500 guys and going into a fugue state and almost getting executed by evil soldiers felt like the most egregious case of something being escalated to a little bit of an absurd degree.
I mean, I think this is built on, because this is supposed to take place, I think, 6 months after the original game, so it's not supposed to be like we've entered this game with these characters as a blank slate, like they've gone through hell and back in that first game, so at this point they're not, at zero. I think she's pretty much already at wit's end when it comes to, pretty much any situation, and she realizes that stranger danger is real because everyone they meet wants to.
But she never bloody learns.
It's hard. I mean, it's hard to avoid strangers. There's a lot of strangers.
Then she runs into that pilgrim camp, and then she just willingly goes along with them. Yeah, it's probably fine.
Oh, like the one in the middle of the forest?
Yeah. What could what could go wrong? Everything that has previously happened could happen.
Because
would be
it goes
my
really
answer.
Quickly. Yeah. Geldon says, I'm surprised Yahtzee didn't complain about the quick time events more. Those look stupidly unrelenting.
That sort of thing just... I guess I barely notice it anymore.
Yeah, so did I. And I don't feel like they were very often or anything.
I think it might be because these are just tutorials at this point.
Yeah.
This is still like the tutorial section.
Yep. I guess narrative dressing aside, like, what did you think, like, later on in the game when you have these combat scenarios and you have a lot more options for fighting and flighting, what did you think about those? Did you find those little sort of action puzzles to be fun at all, or were you kind of bored by them?
It just feels like, you know, the usual standard. Attempt stealth, and if stealth fucks up, just resort to action. Feels kind of like placeholder
gameplay. Did you think the stealth worked well? Like, I mean, did you feel good if you made it through an area without getting caught, or...?
I guess. Because it meant people didn't shout at me so much.
You just didn't want to get yelled at. I appreciate that. It's a very natural response.
Hugo? He's still breathing. It's a shock.
He's
Mia
still
Pickle.
Breathing? Shit!
Mia Pickle with $5 Canadian, thank you so much, says, Yahtzee, if you were the dad in Heavy Rain, how well do you think you'd do?
Probably not very well at all.
Poor little Jason.
Well, it's hard to know how you'd be affected by that sort of thing. I mean, what was his problem? He'd had two kids, and then he lost. One of them died, and then the second one was kidnapped, and he had to go through a bunch of saw traps to get him back.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like you'd need to have gone through the first death to understand the kind of mindset he was in for the rounds of saw traps.
Sure, like, I can't let this happen again.
Yeah. Well, I guess my dog died, and now I've got another dog. So I guess if someone was threatening Toffee, and I had to go through a bunch of saw traps...
Nobody will attack us here, Hugo.
I think I'd balk at hacking anything off me. I think I'd probably draw the line there.
Draw the line? You wouldn't be the man who cut off his finger, who is now a bonus content member?
I guess not. I like my finger. I use it for stuff.
Yes. The Order is very old. They own houses and much, much more.
They built your mother's laboratory and even the Chateau d'Ombrage, remember?
Yes. It's nice they give us a house. That's because you're very...
Boy, the emotional tone of this game swivels on a dime sometimes, isn't it?
Because you're at a nice...
I mean, I sort of zoned out while we were still fleeing from murderous farmers in the apocalyptic burning hellscape. And now we're all having a lovely time in a new city. Oh,
and what a nice little marketplace we get to walk around. Oh my gosh.
Oh,
you can find
feathers.
You can play a little carnival game. You can see a fire breather.
For those who remember my extra punctuation on ghost train rides, we have officially entered the queue.
I think you're just describing, like, Disneyland rides, which I think are great. I love Disneyland.
I'm going to Disneyland next year.
Ooh!
The in-laws want to take their grandchildren to their first Disneyland experience.
Well, that'll be exciting. Are you looking forward to it, or do you have trepidation?
I'm looking forward to seeing how it's updated since I was last there when I was 10 years old.
Oh, that's a long time. Yeah.
First time I was there, they still had the 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea ride, where you get in a little submarine and it goes underwater. And apparently that's been shut down for ages.
It's still at Tokyo Disney, though. Well, at least
I went to Anaheim Disney.
Tokyo Disney still has 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, and they still have an Indiana Jones ride, and Indiana Jones was speaking Japanese, and I found that very funny.
See, I went before the Indiana Jones ride was a thing in Anaheim.
Oh, wow.
It wasn't set up yet.
Kamja Ninja with a $5 dono, thank you so much, says, quote, two men were killed by rats. Obviously, it was the fault of the magical boy. Let's burn down our village and crops in order to kill them and his family. Well, to be fair, those people who were trying to kill you before, you had murdered their son.
It's true.
Yeah, I think that was the main thrust of their concerns.
Yeah. It was less like random people. It was.
But it still feels like going a bit overboard, burning down the entire countryside. Although they didn't intend to burn down the entire countryside, it does feel weird that they continued hunting us while the countryside was burning down. Felt like we should all.
Yeah,
just,
you would think at a certain point you'd be like, well, shit.
Yeah, we probably
we'll save this for another day.
They got Uncharted villain syndrome. They just cannot be dissuaded no matter what the fuck's going on around. We're all like falling out of an aeroplane. Oh, better prioritize trying to kill Nathan Drake.
And Steelclad Gamer, been a member for 6 months, using early access to say Disneyland is great if you're drunk. Of course you did. Don't be like all fucking drunk around kids, though. This is a kid's place.
If you're drunk,
get, like,
and wearing,
get a little tipsy.
If you're drunk and wearing one of the mascot costumes, maybe. Probably have a lot of fun with that. Just discreetly smacks a kid around the head when no one's looking, and then pretend you didn't.
So recently they added Kingdom Hearts characters. Would you be excited to meet like Mage Donald or Warrior Goofy?
No.
Maybe even Sora?
I absolutely would not.
Are you going to get fitted for a Keyblade?
Why would you get fitted for a Keyblade? I'm not going to stick it up my bum.
No, not fitted. Like, you're not. We're not doing the ass stuff. Like the way you get fitted for like a lightsaber or like a wand. I don't know. Like the
I don't think you get fitted for things that you don't wear.
In Harry Potter, don't they get fitted for a wand?
You get fitted for a robe.
But there's like a guy who's like John Hurt. fits you for a wand. So how do we play this? You get four shots to knock down. George Lucas says, don't harass people in costumes. No, no, no. George Lucas, in this scenario, Yahtzee was drunk and in the costume.
Yeah.
He was the costume. Yeah. He was harassing people as the costume. Also, spontaneous sponge with the most specific, well, actually... the Indiana Jones ride isn't at Disneyland, it's at Tokyo Disney Sea, which is a sister park directly next door to it that I think you can get in with the same ticket. So I've just been well actually in that case.
Was it partnered? Is it partnered with a water park? Because that was always the case with Australian theme park. There'd always
it
be
wasn't...
the park and there'd be a water park right next to it.
No, it wasn't even a water park. It was just a lot of the things were like nautical themed. There was one of the places that made me the most uncomfortable, I believe this was at Disney Sea, was a like a giant riverboat that felt like it was from like the late 1800s, early 1900s America. Mm. I was like, ooh, I don't know what's going on here. Like this, I feel like we're gonna get a little weird here. It did not get weird there though. It's great.
Loots. Oh, they're beautiful. Thank you. I make them. Yeah, when the apocalypse hits this city, I know where I'll be looting.
I could play. I'd love to. And don't worry, the apocalypse will hit the city very soon.
Yeah, that's the pattern. Anytime things seem to be going really well, we're like 5 minutes away from things going to shit again.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go see our house. It should be right up here.
And Nightquaker, welcome to Early Access, and said, hey Yahtzee, I'd like to say that I really appreciate your zero punctuation show. It's brought me a lot of good laughs.
I'm glad to hear that. That's very much the intention,
mm-hmm.
to spread the good laughs. And occasionally call people cunts.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I feel like you do the good laughs, so you are able to do that second part.
Spoiler alert, I've been writing my Gotham Knights review, and I feel I'm making very effective use of the word cunt in that review.
Oh, okay. I'm excited for this. I have a feeling you're going to love it.
Gotham Knights.
Yeah, I think you love loot in games, and you like games that try to shoehorn multiplayer.
Yeah, I'm also a big fan of currency. The more currency,
yeah, you are a big fan
better.
Of currency. Yeah, and if you can have different types that are in no way, shape, or form confusing, I think. That's
basically, good. I spent my formative years jerking off in a bureau de change.
I really like the way that sentence sounded. I don't like the idea of doing that, but I like the way that sentence sounded.
Jerking off in a bureau de change.
I think
it sounds classier when you put it in French, doesn't it?
Yeah, even the public masturbation.
Yeah.
In Storyteller, because Teller was...
Mère de chien et gravier. That means dog turds in gravel.
Perfect. Storyteller, because Teller was taken 0-2 with a 5-pound dono. Thank you so much. So, speaking of ghost trains, Marty, did you ever watch... Did you ever watch The Evil Within? Starts with a ghost train. Would be interested to hear your thoughts.
Are we talking Evil about Within, the game?
The game? The
Evil Within?
Because I played both of them. Or is The Evil Within a movie?
Suppose it probably is. There's
like, there is a movie called Evil Within.
There are an awful lot of movies. And that sounds there like is, sort of name a movie might have.
There is a movie called Evil Within that was starring one of the Boondock Saints who was not Norman Reedus. No, I have not seen that movie. I've not seen that movie. It is not based on the video game The Evil Within. That's it. Those are the two things I learned. I do like the idea of ghost trains, though. I've liked ghost trains ever since the Phantom Toll Booth. It's got good ghost trains, and Final Fantasy VI had a good ghost train as well.
Oh yeah, that's the classic ghost train.
Yeah, that you can suplex.
Because you can suplex it, yeah.
Exactly.
I am keen to go on the Haunted Mansion ride at Disneyland again and see if it's much like I remember.
Was that? Do you remember what your favorite ride was when you went when you were young?
I don't know if it was my favorite. The Haunted Mansion ride is certainly the one that sticks out in my memory the most. I liked all that sort of pre-ride stuff where you go in the room and the room descends and the paintings enlarge.
Yeah, I thought that was really cool too. I always preferred the rides that were more like felt like little stories as opposed to just like here's a roller coaster. Like I liked the Twilight Zone Tower of Terror. I liked all the like accoutrement around it and like the story you were told as you were waiting in line and everything. And I like falling down an elevator is neat, but like I like the wrappings around it more.
Yes. All right. Yeah, fair enough. Pirates of the Caribbean and all that.
Yeah.
And my wife is diligently getting my daughter enthusiastic for the Small World ride by playing it on YouTube a lot. It's very annoying.
Is that going to be a song that you're just going to have to listen?
She was worried that we'd be taking that he wouldn't get much. That she wouldn't get much out of Disneyland because you know she's just a kid.
Yeah.
So my wife's been trying to like get her into Disney stuff in preparation, and it's a little bit backfired because my daughter has spent the last few weeks declaring herself to be Mickey Mouse.
Oh, you know you get arrested at Disneyland if you claim that.
Well, we've tried to explain that, but she won't be deterred. She wouldn't tolerate thought of any other costume for Halloween. We got her a Mickey Mouse costume, and she's worn it like 19 times in preparation for Halloween.
That's great. I get stuck in the logic of it. Substances obey natural law. The macula does. Kamja Ninja with a $5 donation. Thank you so much. Says, so you guys are industry types. Is there a particular reason why there's been an influx of French developed video games in the past few years?
I don't know. Maybe there's been like a government scheme. There was one of those in Brisbane in Queensland a while back. The government would just randomly put arts funding into video games and fund a bunch of new things.
Yeah, I think there's also you know, France had a lot of Ubisoft studios, and a lot of times you see folks from AAA studios. Like Nick and I were talking about this on the Nick finished streaming the Outlast 2 last night, and the
that
developer
game
of the
sucks.
Outlast games, Red Bros. And people were mentioning how you hated that game in the while we were playing it.
I don't care if they were mentioning it. I want to know if they were agreeing with me that it sucks.
No, they were just mentioning. Everyone was saying, "God damn, Yahtzee was wrong." No, I think they just were saying it. I don't remember what the general consensus was. I think Nick and I's general consensus on the game was, I think we were both had some good spooks, but
it doesn't make sense and it sucks.
I think I just have no opinion on the game. I thought the game it just was. But anyways, Red Barrels, the team who made that, were all former Ubisoft developers, so they had all worked on stuff like Prince of Persia and Splinter Cell and the original Assassin's Creed. So I think a lot of times you get AAA studios, and the folks there spread their wings and want to make other stuff. And I don't know, what other big French studios? There's Arkane, I guess Arkane Lyon.
Arkane, Ubisoft, Remember Adeline software back in the day? They made Little Big Adventure and a couple of other things. Ooh,
Little
Delphine
Big
software. Ooh, what's Delphine software. They made Flashback, one of the pioneering realistic platformers from the 2D era.
I do remember Flashback.
Also, Another World, which was called Out of This World in the US, which was an early pioneer in polygon-based animation.
Yeah. That was Eric Chahi, I think. The auteur behind that.
That was Eric Chahi.
Yeah.
Good old Eric Chahi. So there's a very strong video game development tradition in France.
Good. That's a start. I should have known.
Of course he doesn't go by his Scavenger said, Marty, quote, I have no opinion. Sleep. Well, I had no opinion on the game because Nick was the one playing it, and my feed was like 30 seconds behind, so I don't know. He would scream, and then I'd be like, oh, a spooky thing's going to happen, and then it would happen, so I wasn't even listening to it, so I wouldn't say I played the game. We're looking for the florist stand? But I'm also probably not going to play the game, so yeah.
I think Cocktail Vision was French as well. They made old point-click adventure games. They made the Goblins series.
Mm-hmm. What was... I don't know what Goblins was.
Well, there was a game called Goblins. There was like a point-click adventure where you controlled three dudes with different abilities. And it was spelled with three I's. That's why I say it like that.
Goblins?
Goblins. One I for each of the characters you control. And then it had a sequel called Goblins 2, where you controlled two characters. So there was just two I's in Goblins.
Oh no, then is the last game going to be really sad because the other two goblins have died and it's just goblins with an eye?
They were different goblins.
They were different goblins, gotcha.
Yeah. And the third game, there was only one goblin, so there was only one eye.
That's what I said. That's perfect. That's very clever of them.
He had other party members who weren't goblins, though, just to confuse matters. This is why you should pay attention to the dialogue. I can't remember what we're supposed to be doing now.
Alex English said Goblin D's Nuts.
Oh, we're going to the florist. Right.
Goblin D's Nuts. Dialecticoma says, I don't think I've ever seen Marty play a game. I've never actually played a game. Oh, and the only game I've been playing Marvel Snap on my phone. And that's the only game I've ever played.
Great game. Snap? Phone Snap. Snap is a thing.
Marvel Snap. It is a Marvel, I know this is your favorite genre, deck builder. Two things you love in life, the Marvel superheroes
is it
and
actually
deck
Snap,
builder.
Where you put down cards and when two cards of the same card come up, you have to slap your hand on it and say Snap.
It is not, no.
It's not that? Okay.
No. Well, that's, I had that game. That wasn't called, well, I think we had a vulgar name for it. I think that game was called Asshole.
Okay.
When we played it in college.
Is it also related to Pokemon Snap?
It's not related to Pokemon Snap.
You have to
Snap,
go down a little ghost train ride taking pictures of Marvel characters as they jump out of bushes.
You can't call... Okay, Pokemon Snap isn't a ghost train ride. It's a literal train ride.
Okay, fine. It's a train ride.
That's just a literal train ride. Although in one of the levels there are ghost Pokemon, so I guess that would be a ghost train ride.
Well, there you go. Brown tunic. Thank you for
your help. Scavenger with a $5 dono. Thank you so much. Scavenger said, recent video effects artist React discussed pre-rendered versus in-engine cutscenes and how each has pluses and negatives. Any thoughts from you two?
No. Just convey the story well. Who cares?
Yeah. I'm mostly in the same boat. I think at this point I would just rather have parity between visuals and the cutscenes and the...
Yeah, at least in engine cutscenes, you can have the characters wearing the silly unlockable costumes you found.
Like I think that is the big thing. If you go to a cutscene...
Go through Dead Rising with, like, the Servbot head on Frank all the time. And it makes the game, like, twice as funny.
Yeah. I'm playing through Persona 5 again on Switch, and the new versions of the game come with all the DLC, which includes, like, different outfits, and you can put on outfits from like you could dress up as characters from like 4 and 3, and so I was going through a dungeon dressed as all the characters from 4, but then during cutscenes they would just show the Phantom Thieves look in their regular ass like Phantom Thief outfits, and
that's
I was like, this is not what they're wearing. What are you doing?
Lame. I want to wear my surf pop mask while a serious emotional reaction goes on between Frank West and another character. He's in here. No one gets in. The arena is off limits.
Why is that?
Because the Count of Provence said... Maelstrom said, don't use cutscenes, set up your story up in a way that is told through the environment and characters. Well, I don't think that's a hard and fast rule that needs to be followed.
Yeah, I think if you stick to that rule, then you'll probably get frustrated.
No.
Sorry.
There's a door up there.
Yes.
Yeah, someone else in the comments mentioned that they hated the way the characters in this game just never fucking shut up. You know what? Struck me as weird was the way characters say yes so much in this game.
Come on.
It's like, there's a door up there. Yes.
I didn't notice that.
We need to help Hugo get to what's his name. Yes.
I didn't notice that at all. Now I'm worried that I'm just going to start noticing it.
I mean, I know it's a common word, but you can sort of make a drinking game out of when characters just say yes.
Yeah.
Spreading. Hugo. We brought it here.
Let's find Magister Volta. If he's not dead already.
Yeah, you brought the plague here. You knowingly brought the plague here. In the form of your little brother.
But they didn't think it would get out of control.
Why didn't you... like set up home in a tower in the middle of nowhere and ask the Magister of Odin to come to you.
Maybe.
Because alchemists are assholes and notoriously do not travel for work.
Well, they certainly are in this game, but you think they'd have some investment in coming to see this, like, once in 600 years rebirth of the Rat Whisperer. You'd think they'd take an interest.
Little rat boy. Slip Chicken says, put him on an island. Oh, they try that. Don't you think they don't try that?
They try it with a densely populated island, is probably the issue. With a cult on it, lest we forget. A death cult.
Spoilers, it is a death. Well, aren't all cults death cults?
Death cult with a lot of the Wicker Man about it.
Oh, yeah, some heavy Wicker Man vibes, yeah.
Yeah, that was the mistake. More bloody whispering.
You're alone, and I have all the time in the world. Just talk to me. Please, let me go.
That brute is not a soldier.
George Lucas says the French sometimes say yes at the end of a sentence. Yes?
Oui. Oui. Non. No.
I'm sorry, Scavenger, I insulted alchemists again. Well, alchemists, no, they're busy. Alchemists can't make house visits. I don't know if alchemists are busy.
They're just like doctors in this setting, aren't they?
Yeah, but I feel like this place has to have actual doctors, right?
I assume.
Amicia's probably killed them all. Surgeons, there were doctors.
Medicine men. Barbers who'd also lop your leg off if you asked.
Andrew Kabanum said, still got PTSD from the bloody polygonal vagina from the end of last night's Outlast 2 stream. Yeah, do you remember Outlast 2 ends with a...
Yes, I very distinctly remember how Outlast 2 ends.
Yeah, you could see the whole birth. I thought it was great. Nick was very uncomfortable. Somehow, I thought it was wonderful.
Simultaneously, yes, the ending of Outlast 2, somehow simultaneously overdoing it and disappointing. You're going to bugger off then, Mr. Leather Straps Around the Knees.
Anthony Gonzalez says, will we ever get a second mailbag showdown? I don't know what that is.
Probably not.
All right, probably not.
I was in a very early episode of Zero Punctuation when I felt the need to directly respond to the response to my Smash Brothers Brawl review.
When did you start doing these kind of streams where you could sort of more in-depth explain?
It was after I moved to the U.S. Around 2016.
Gotcha. Were people mad? Did you not like Smash Brothers Brawl, and were people mad at you?
I expressed the usual sentiments I express when addressing Nintendo first-party properties, and you know how people are.
To be fair, that's the one. That game wasn't great. In the history of Smash games, I think that one is
well, at least it put the effort into having a proper single-player campaign.
Oh yeah, that was the was
the Subspace Emperor.
The Subspace Emissary. Yeah.
Emissary, that was it.
I think that was written like Nomura, I think, had a part in it or something. The Kingdom Hearts guy.
Please, no. Up there. Looks like it leads back inside.
Let's find something to get up there. Quick.
Why can't you be more like that pig, Amicia? That pig's finding something positive in this situation.
There's some sort of half cart here, but it's not high enough. I think they were moving the bodies.
This bothers me as well. Guards just seem unnaturally violent. Violence prone because they need to be established to be big enough assholes that you have no quarrels killing them. It just feels manipulative. I think that's
I'd agree
things,
with that.
Though. No. But that's most things, right?
Well, not necessarily. I mean,
in every game that you're killing people, they have to like portray them as bad enough for you to kill, right?
Yeah, but they have to work a lot harder to portray them as bad enough to kill in this game because the main characters are making the worst decisions possible. And we wish they'd stop.
Let's go, quick.
I mean, clearly these guards are bad people because they're secretly killing a bunch of the poor people and just throwing them in ditches.
Yeah, and that's the amount of work the writers need to do to make us sympathize with the main characters.
Because that isn't the main that much work. Because that's just the scenario.
But the main characters are so fundamentally unsympathetic, they have to make the guards like really unrealistically huge assholes to compensate.
The main characters are incredibly sympathetic.
I think is the point. We're back to that argument again, aren't we?
We are back to that one. Hey, you got a knife, I saw. I'm a little bit behind the stream, but you got a knife. You're probably gonna
I will stab to death some poor bastard who's doing his job, but it's okay because he uses a slightly harsh tone of voice.
But you will only stab them in the death in the neck once, and you will leave the knife behind because the knife is consumable. That's always a thing in games. I'm like, what are we? Last of Us does the same thing. I'm like, let's pull the knife out.
If I was stabbed and someone left the knife in me and ran off, I'd look down and sit and think, geez, I think even worse of you for this. Christ. I was murdered by a complete buffoon. Well, that's a great moment to end my life with. Blech.
QB says, are the main characters the only non-adults in this game?
At the start.
Yeah, and I guess what's this kid you're with now? Lucas?
Yeah, we're with Lucas, kind of a non-adult. You know, the MVP of the plot.
But yeah, most of the people you come across, and especially the, without spoiling it, you kind of have you find a different ally in every act of the game.
Yeah, they got different powers
that you can use, and most of them are adults.
Yeah. Sometimes you're with Lucas, I think it's half and half. Sometimes you're with Lucas, sometimes you're with Hugo. Sometimes you're with a hairy dude with a shield, and sometimes you're with that smuggler lady. So I think it's like two of each.
Yeah. Why do you keep calling him hairy dude with a shield? He's just a dude.
He's also hairy, though.
Yeah, I guess he is hairy. Was he like a crusader? He was angry. That guy was very angry.
I think he was like a mercenary.
It's probably not great that neither of us remember. We both played through this game like 2 weeks ago.
Well, I've had to play through Gotham Knights since then.
That's just changed your outlook on everything?
Well, it's probably because it filled my entire schedule with incredibly tedious grind for several days. Alright, so what now?
Who's there? I'm stabbing someone in the neck.
Get spotted by an archer is what we do now.
Spencer K with a $5 donation. Thank you so much. Spencer says, thoughts on the MetaQuest Pro AR capabilities. Is VR any closer to becoming mainstream, or will it forever be an expensive niche?
The second one.
You think it'll always be an expensive niche?
Oh, there's a hole here. I see. Yeah, I mean, I've always said it's probably always going to be niche because there's certain fundamentals about the experience that a lot of people don't really like. Like having to shut off your entire sensory perception of the world around you. A lot of people sort of bounce off that.
Yeah. Well, that was this question was thoughts on, so the MetaQuest Pro has kind of like AR capabilities, like the ability to see what is going around. You see what is going on around you and then have the VR, not be VR, but be AR.
Yeah, but only if you turn on a special setting.
Yeah. I always feel like AR has much more of a chance of becoming fully mainstream than VR. Mostly because of what Yahtzee said. Yeah, I don't think it is human nature to want to just completely immerse yourself. That people are always like, I want immersion, but there's like a certain amount of immersion that I think is too much immersion. You don't want to be so immersed that your house is on fire and you don't know it.
Yeah.
I also think until it's as like simple as putting on a pair of glasses, like once you need a, if it's $1,000 and you need a PC, you need a bunch of wires, you need a bunch of space, then it's not a easy thing to show people, sort of show off.
Can't be. I have to check this. Hey Archer, keep looking that way. I bet there's lots of really interesting things. Oh bugger! That was your own bloody fault.
Huh?
And now I'm going to stab you.
Oops. Andrew Hickenbottom of the 2-pound dono. Thank you so much, Andrew. And have you ever tried to crouch walk in real life? It is hard. Yeah, every video game character, Lee Kamjin just says, has thighs like a tree trunk.
Yeah, and all of them can do that thing where you put your feet outside of the ladder and slide down the ladder while holding
it. Oh, yeah.
That's also really hard.
You've never done that?
Well, you'd burn all the skin off your hands.
You would absolutely burn all the skin off your hands. Yeah.
Okay, so far we're getting points in opportunism. This is that thing where you get points in different skills depending on what you do. I'm not really sold on that generally as a mechanic because I feel like that subtracts the sort of the player's intention to play a certain way. It sort of locks the player into whatever they sort of accidentally fall into doing. Like sometimes I want to play through games stealthy, but if the game is going, oh, you fucked up, here's some points to make you better at fighting, and I'm like, I don't want to be better at fighting. I want to be better at stealth.
Well then be better at stealth.
Why should I have to? I've got upgrades for that.
I like that. I feel like it almost encourages me to play in ways I wouldn't normally. Like in the same way I like that. Like, for instance, the guns in Ratchet and Clank upgrade as you use them. So
yeah, I hate that as well. Because
You
upgrade all your favorite guns, and then you're like, well, I can't use my favorite gun now because I would waste the experience. So I have to use the shitty guns I don't like.
Yeah, but then it encourages you to use all the guns.
Yeah, most of them suck.
But then just use the guns you like.
But then I'll be wasting the experience because the gun I like is fully upgraded.
But if you don't want the other guns, it's not wasting the experience. At that point, you no longer care about the experience, right?
I think in multiple ways we're running up against impasses based on what kind of people we are.
I think this is like a therapy session where at the end of it we could figure out what each other's like. I like this. Yeah.
You say tomato, I say tomato.
I kill 10,000 people to save my brother. You let your brother die. Adam Padilla with a $5 dono. Thank you so much, Adam. Said, on another note, Marty, you criticized yourself for playing Persona 4 times, but it makes you feel better. I'm on my third run of Metal Gear Solid 5, which I will 100%. Why criticize myself? I don't feel bad for it.
Playing through MGS5 three times? Jesus.
That is a lot. Of all the Metal Gear games, that's probably the one I would not play through three times.
Seems like it'd be a bit of a slog.
But you know what? At the same time, play what you like. If it makes you happy, that's great. If it makes you happy and you're not killing 20,000 people with all of your rats, then it's fine.
People I worry about are people who play things that don't make them happy.
Yeah,
like people who feel like they have to get 100% in every game. And half the time, if you ask them if they're having fun, they'll say, no, I'm not having fun, but I have to get 100% in this game.
Yeah.
Otherwise, what's the point? And that's not the mindset you want to be in.
It's also the same, like, people who just keep watching a show that they hate, I'm like, well, just stop it, just watch something else. You don't have to keep doing this to yourself. It's very easy to not do something.
But I'm invested. Just be careful.
And Katura Cowboy, thank you so much for 35ZAR. I had a weird dream where Marty waited till we were alone and tased me. Here is some money. Please don't hurt me, Marty.
And another thing, why do structures always only collapse when we step on them in games like this?
Maybe a player character is very dense.
Well, we know Amicia is. Boom!
Ah! Waka waka!
yeah, we landed in some corpses. It was harrowing when Lara Croft did it. You've done it like 9 times in these games.
Jonathan Grover said, holy shit, I've been watching Zero Punctuation for 15 consecutive years. It's probably the thing in my life I've been most consistent with, period. Well, that's great. Now you've probably been breathing.
And if I went away, you'd kill yourself.
Jesus. No. There's other things.
Hey, finally we get some rat physics.
Rats.
Which, as I say, jolly impressive, technically speaking.
Oh yeah, there's a lot of rats. I also hope we get some rat glitches, because when the rats glitch out, very funny.
I find it fun to just pick a rat and just follow them across the screen. Because they could have very easily just sort of fudged with this, with the sort of texture effect, but no.
Yeah,
every single rat moves individually.
Yeah. Tommy Salty says, is Waka Waka a thing that people from
ignore
Wisconsin
them.
Stay instead of laughing?
Ignore them. Great advice, Amicia.
I think it's great advice.
Because they're, they're so bloody easy to ignore.
Tommy Salty, Waka Waka is a thing that Fozzie Bear on The Muppets says.
Man, he didn't know that.
Tommy Salty, they don't have The Muppets in Poland.
Huh. Feels weird to think of a world without The Muppets.
I feel like they have The Muppets in Poland. What did you think of the sort of the rat puzzle areas? So not the combat ones, but like how are we going to get through this tomb filled with rats?
Yeah, it's fine. I feel the same way I felt about them when they were in the first game.
This one gives you a lot more things. You can turn off lights. You can make your fire brighter. Can put rat lures in places. I like that one thing that you can use that's like a fire whip, that's like a get out of jail free card.
Oh yeah. Oh, he said yes, take a drink.
Oh no. Maelstrom said, do they ever form a Rat King? There's going to be Rat King DLC that you have to fight.
I feel like it would be pretty easy to fight a Rat King.
They're so scary looking.
They're not very efficient, though.
Oh, but they're so gross.
We'll stamp on it, then. Then no more Rat King.
Nightquaker says, Yahtzee, would you ever form a rat cult?
That would be mental.
Okay, so no. Hickabottom says, the music sounds a bit weird, like a bassy dubstep. I know the music was pretty good. I think it's kind of like when you get into rat scenarios, it's more of like psychological horror music.
Yeah, it's more lots of sort of sudden sweeps of the violin.
Yeah. Yeah, George, it's the Rat King from Dark Souls 2. What a shit boss. That rat boss is fucking terrible in Dark Souls 2.
We all know what a Rat King is, right?
Yeah, it's when they all get, like, all their tails get,
glom together, and there's a big old mass of rats.
I assume some people aren't familiar with the phenomenon.
Yes. One brazier at a time. Not to be confused with the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle villain, the Rat King, who's just like a poor man in the sewers.
The light doesn't reach the ladder.
The lock on that chain looks weak.
I see it.
Shawshank, you know what boss we were talking about. It wasn't called the Rat King, it was just a bunch of rats. Gotta actually the Rat King.
It was called the Royal Rat Vanguard. I know that without having to look it up.
Look at that. Sometimes you just gotta let people say things and understand what they're talking about.
And there was the Royal Rat Authority, which was a different boss fight.
See? Yahtzee knew all that and he didn't correct me. He was just thinking less of me in his head. And Tommy Salty with Tens Woe, do you thank you so much. Tommy says, we are a backwater country, but we watched the Muppets.
Is that like the straight-to-video knockoff of the Muppets?
Was there like the Muppets Take Warsaw?
Those bootleg like Disney DVDs you used to see, where they animate it on the cheap and call it Aladdin. Because, you know, it's a public domain story.
Yeah.
They can do that.
Andrew Hickenbottom with 3-pound dono. Thank you so much, Andrew. Said, can the rats form a giant fist like in old cartoons?
They did form the first game, didn't they? Yeah, they form like little, like, tornadoes.
Yeah.
Because there's so many, like, the checkpoints are so close together in this game, death doesn't feel that impactful after a while.
Yeah, but it's also not frustrating, which I would much rather have close checkpoints than, like, because some of these, I think, I liked most of the rat puzzles. Some of them can be pretty janky, and sometimes you'll, like, you get an ability to sort of throw out a thing that will lure the rats there for a shorter period of time. And sometimes it won't lure all the rats, and then a couple will nibble on you and slow you down enough for you to die. And so if I had to start all the way back, that'd be annoying. So I'm perfectly fine with very often checkpoints and short loading times.
Amicia doesn't appreciate Lucas.
At least Lucas is like pretty self-reliant compared to Hugo. But counterpoint.
Yeah, and she doesn't appreciate him for it.
But Lucas can't control rats.
He can control the alchemical forces, though.
He can, yeah.
He can produce a seemingly limitless quantity of random shit.
And he has the ability to not be the carrier of a biblical plague.
Yeah, that's a big plus in my book.
Massive plus, yeah.
But then again, without the biblical plague, he wouldn't have need to show off his alchemical skills. So
it's,
you know, swings and roundabouts.
Scavenger with a $5 dono says, would it be better if this was Star Trek and Tribble Swarms? Skulk around Cardassian guards, watch floods of cooling furballs, and spill out of the vents. Watch floods
Tribbles,
of cooling...
Tribbles would never hurt us. Tribbles are our friends.
Are Tribbles nice little Star Trek rats?
Tribbles are nice.
Okay.
Tribbles are little furry, adorable things that are really cute and make great pets, and the problem they cause in Star Trek episodes is that they breed like bacteria.
That's not good. That's worrisome.
But they never actually cause any actual harm themselves. They just like being cute.
But if there was like 200,000 of them, that would be worrisome, right?
You'd think in the future they'd know how to neuter their tribbles.
Have your tribbles spayed and neutered?
I'm going to need you.
Sure. Wow.
Oh no. Do you hear that? And Katura Cowboy with another donation. Thank you so much. Said follow up on the dream thing. In another dream, Nick died on stream by being eaten by an alligator. So make sure not to stream near any.
Well, I hope we got a lot of donations after that happened.
Yeah. This is the Nick funeral fund of him dying on stream because of a gator. Nick did tell me he's not going to be there tonight for Breakout, so it is possible he's planning to be eaten by a gator.
He's busy pulling his leg out of some jaws.
Let's try to keep these rats occupied first. Don't fall. Thank you, Lucas.
Are there alligators in Wisconsin? I don't think there's any natural alligators in Wisconsin. There are, there's gators at zoos, and there's like a reptile park in northern Wisconsin. I don't think there's any. Unless we go to the Milwaukee Zoo, I don't think we're going to see any gators in Wisconsin.
Hey, if you don't like rats, Amicia, I know an easy way to get rid of them.
Does it involve kinslaying?
Well, try not to think of it in those terms. Think of it as, you know, pest control.
No, it's your brother!
Well, he was going to die anyway in like 100 years.
Well, everyone's going to die anyway in 100 years.
Exactly. Why get attached?
I don't think any of us are going to make it to 100. Who on the escapists do you think will live the longest?
Nick, because he's like 14, isn't he?
Yeah, I mean, like, who will die at the oldest age?
Oh, well, probably not me, because I'm 6'5", and the pattern is that larger than average people live shorter than average lives.
That's not good.
Remember Andre the Giant? Our systems just pack in sooner than everyone else's.
Amy takes care of herself. Casey doesn't drink. That's good. So maybe Casey.
It'll probably be Amy. She lives in Australia. They've got free healthcare. She'll be the last one left, just remembering us all. Sitting in her rocking chair. Thinking back to the days when she was Dabarella.
But what if Amy is so smitten by her week in Milwaukee while filming Adventures Nigh Season 3 that she decides to move there?
She won't. She's been worried about getting caught in gun crime, because that's the perception of America around the world.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Frankly, I sympathize. I'd probably go back to Australia if I could.
I do too. Trey Rumsey with $1.99 dono. Thank you so much. Says Marty, what does Waka Waka mean? Waka Waka is what Fozzie is. The Muppets just a thing old people know? Do young people not know the Muppets?
Wasn't there a Simpsons joke sort of playing off the fact that only old people know what the Muppets are?
Oh, I mean, if there is, you wanna know what's fucking really weird? So you know how the Simpsons does their yearly Treehouse of Horrors like spooky episode?
Yes.
They still do that, and the one that is upcoming, I believe it's on Sunday. One of the three stories. You remember how like the stories were, one would be like a take on The Shining and a take on The Blob. One is a take on Death Note, animated by some of the original animators of Death Note. And I find that so weird. What? It's just so weird to me.
In Japanese anime style rather than Simpsons style?
Yeah, it's like the Simpsons characters, but in anime style.
Well, nothing really surprises me about the Simpsons anymore. They've done everything.
Been running for 35 years or whatever.
We have sulfur and alcohol. It's too much. The best basis for an ignifer. Highly reactive.
Waka Waka is also a song by Shakira, and Waka Waka is the noise that Pac-Man makes. So, yes.
Well, that's true.
My Waka Wakas are always in reference to Fozzie Bear, unless specifically noted.
I think that's all we want to hear about your Waka Wakas for now.
Can I talk about just one Waka? Like the Waka from Final Fantasy X? That's just a singular Waka.
I was trying to remember who Waka was. Thank you for reminding me.
Yeah, he was the Blitzball player. See, Andrew Hickenbottom knows. And Skim Shady with a $5 donation. Thank you so much. Said this game rewrites history to credit the French with the Black Plague instead of the Mongols. Typical whitewashing Hollywood.
I don't think it's the Black Plague.
It's not the plague. This is just its own
being killed by rats.
This is a fictional rat thing.
Because the Black Plague, of course, was a bunch of French people. The Black Plague was not spread by rat bites; it was spread by flea bites. The rats just, you know, were carriers of the fleas.
Yeah.
Where are we going?
And yes, Shitface Johnson, Waka Flocka Flame is a rapper. And yes, Shitface Johnson might be my favorite name of anyone in the chat.
What now?
Cages. They had other beasts in there.
Whatever. Let's light this place up.
Everyone in chat agrees that Amy will be the one to live longest, so congrats, Amy.
Yes. Wait, J-Mate's like 12 years old, right?
No, he's not surprisingly old, but he's like closer to my age, so I think he's in his 30s. I think?
He looks 12 years old.
He has a number in his name, so he could be younger.
He's 8 years old. Oh, that's right.
Jamaican's 28. There we go.
Yeah, he's like 11 years younger than me, which is basically the same as being 8 years old.
Do you think you're 19?
I am forever the correct age. If you're younger than me, you're too young.
Do you forget your age ever? I forget my age relatively often.
I never forget my age because I'm pushing 40, motherfucker.
I mean, forget it by like a year or two.
No, I'm always pretty much aware of it. I was born in 1983. I'm having serious troubles with this staircase. Okay. I'm not sure what I was doing wrong there, but we seem to have sorted it out.
KingDead42 with a $5 donation. Thank you so much. Said, thanks, Marty. I just realized I am now older than the number in my name. I think we have a lot of 40-year-olds in the... KingDead is older than 42. Andrew Hickenbottom's 43.
All right. Let's move this beast. Is too heavy.
That's what the crank on the other side is for. You need two people.
All right, you stay there.
Nick called me old yesterday because I said that after our fucking 13 hours of streaming on Saturday, all day Sunday, my neck hurt. And he called me old. And I was like, is that an old thing? Or is that just like, hey, I stared at the screen for 13 hours and my neck hurts?
I think that's needing a better chair thing.
Yeah. I think it's just man's not meant to be looking at fucking monitors for 13 hours. Yeah, we have a lot of 40-year-olds in the chat. You guys are great. Simple. Yeah. Simon, Guglop, Bearstronaut. Yeah, Wraithbo, my chair is really nice. My problem is I think I need to change my posture. I tend to lean forward, mostly because of I don't have a microphone boom arm. I have a microphone that I put on various books and boxes. I should probably just get one of those little boom arms. I should also just not stream for 13 hours straight.
Oh, the Xbox are back.
To the crank now.
They've been horned up all stream, let me tell you.
All right, Lucas, I'm there. I'm waiting for your go.
Does anyone actually get suckered in by those? Does anyone genuinely look at those Xbox things that, you know what, I do feel like looking at hot singles right now.
But the crazy thing about them is Well, here, let me unhide them to see if I'm right. Is that they don't have like a link? It's just a message. And so, like, I don't know what, like, what is the, you know, what is the point of it?
They're just generally reminding you of the concept of sex, in case you've forgotten, I suppose.
Yeah, it's sometimes nice to know that there are hot singles in your area.
Yeah, it's a sort of reaffirming, really.
Yeah.
If things ever feel bad, I just remember there are hot singles in my area. And suddenly the world seems a little brighter.
To click on their profile. Okay, I'm gonna click on the profile the next time one comes. I'm gonna do some investigative journalism. Yes, the scavenger literally said, I'm tempted to click on it and investigate so I can tell others what happens, like an investigative reporter.
I wouldn't do that on a computer I used for anything else, to be honest. I probably want to set up like a emulated machine before I clicked on any links.
So I should use it on like my porno computer in the other room?
Yeah, your designated porno computer.
Before the bite, yes. A vegetable garden. Oh, look at that. Hey, what are you doing here? Whoever
planted it. People are very worried about my computer getting viruses, which I appreciate. And Beastmarch, with a file or dono, thank you so much, said, Yahtzee, I enjoyed your EP on missing E3, and I said in the comments that I missed going to professional conferences as well. I hope you get to go back.
Well, it's back to in-person E3s. Next year, isn't it?
That's right. Yeah, I think we'll be
attending.
I imagine Nick will want to go. At least a little skeleton crew. Always the funny thing about E3 is it always makes sense to have like a ground team and a home team because there's a bunch of streams and stuff you want to be able to handle. Yeah. But then you also have the stuff you could do there. So it almost makes sense to send like you, Nick, and like Omar. Little dream.
I think that was what we found, yes.
Yeah.
We were in person for the Microsoft presentation. For the others, we just like hung out at the Airbnb and watched it on TV.
Yeah, being in the room at the presentations, I think I've been to like each major conference once, and then after that I was like, I don't need to do this.
Being there in person gave me more faith in my fellow man. Because I realized that when you look at them on TV and see all these crowds of cheering spectators, you don't realize that there's a whole extra crowd that the camera isn't looking at, that are just sitting there, arms folded, looking very skeptical.
And that a lot of times the crowds they are cutting to are like, there's a whole section of employees, so it's a bunch of like Microsoft employees who are really excited every time they show a Forza game.
Oh boy, I wonder if we're about to go into a section with human soldiers. Oh, what do you know? There they are.
Murder. Jack Manson, with a $2 donation, thank you so much, said, this, that, the VA of both the semester, it sounds it. This, that, the VA of both the semester, it sounds it. Does that mean anything to you? Was that like an old show you did?
No, I'm not sure what they're banging on about.
Jack Manson, please clarify. Scavenger with a $5 dono, thank you so much, says, somewhere out there is a person trying desperately to help their single friends meet people and avoid becoming mail order brides. Hashtag not all sex bots. And yes, Jack Manson, you did fuck that up, but if you just have, your donation is wonderful, and if you have anything you want to say, just say that. And I'll say it out. You can think of that as a sloppy copy.
Yeah.
Do you not like the term sloppy copy either?
I just don't really like the word sloppy in any context, to be honest.
I use the word sloppy copy a lot, and Nick and Casey do not like it. That's what we call them as kids. We call the first draft sloppy copies. Oh, maybe that's a Wisconsin thing. And Dingus Squatford Jr. with a £5 dono, thank you so much, says, you could tell what age you were by what button you fasten on your shirt.
if you fasten the top, you're in the 20s. The second button, you're in your 30s. And the third, you're in your 40s.
Okay. What I didn't realize that was the rule.
Like, people in their 20s don't unbutton? That can't be true. People in their 20s are buttoned up all the way to their necks? How do they breathe?
I always thought the rule for the buttons on suit jackets was from top to bottom, always, sometimes, never. Always button the top one, but you'd never do all the buttons up because you look like a dog.
Yeah.
One wonders why the button's there at all, but I didn't make the rules.
Yeah. When I button shirts, I usually start in the middle, and honestly, probably 75% of the time, I've realized I fucked it up when I get to the bottom, and then I've buttoned that they're not, the buttons aren't aligned, and I have to do it again. And that's just, I just realized I'm not going to learn at that point. So, old dog, new tricks kind of thing.
It's so hard being a teenage murderer.
It is true.
No one has the common courtesy to turn around.
See, American Fear knows starting in the middle is a dangerous game. Yeah, Brubarian, I know I should start from the bottom. People have told me, like roommates, people I've dated, everyone has always told me. I like to live life on the edge.
So I want to kill that archer, but that dude's close enough he'd hear my sling. Is the problem.
Oh, Jack Manson with another... You didn't need to donate another $5. You could have just posted the message and I would have read it. But Jack Manson... Oh, pulled it. Gotcha. Said, was that the voice actor for Bach, the seamster, in Elden Ring? Sounds like it.
Okay.
I don't remember what Bach sounds like. I'm also not listening to this. Voice actor. Calvin A. Dean is the voice of Bach. We'll see if Calvin A. Dean was in A Plague Tale. It looks like no. Rest in peace, Calvin A. Dean. Calvin A. Dean is not dead, don't worry, guys. And Theo Fastris Bombastris von Honheim. That was a very long name. With a €5 donation, thank you so much. Said, dear Yahtzee, thank you for your review. It's great to see that you stay true to your opinions, even though everyone tries to convince you that you're wrong. Who's trying to convince him that he's wrong? I didn't say he's wrong, I just said I disagree with him.
Yeah, you can't have a wrong opinion.
You can't have a wrong opinion.
They are an inherently subjective thing.
Exactly.
Although that said, you know, there are cases where, you know, if someone says they enjoyed listening to someone singing completely out of tune, who had like a pint of gravel in the back of their throat, that would probably be a wrong opinion.
Maybe that's their kink. Don't kink shame.
Oh, bugger. Seems to remember really hating this section first time I was playing.
Yeah, there was a couple sections where I was like, I'm not a big fan of this level layout. I'm just going to find the exit and run there. And then I'd get there and I'd be like, all right, open a door, close it. Everything's safe. No one would ever follow us.
Hey, your dudes, your friends are being eaten by rats, mate. Priorities.
Okay.
Oh.
Dingus Van Zant with a highlighted message over on Twitch. Thank you so much. Said, I was going to say, so Yahtzee likes Daniel Johnson too, or Bob Dylan? I think that was in reference to the singing from the back of your throat thing.
Thank you, Lucas. Thank you for your contribution. They've seen us! Go back to sleep.
Lintux with a 542 donation. Thank you so much. Lintux says men should button all of the buttons on a suit jacket. That can't be right. Some ancient English king shouldn't be still dictating American fashion in the 21st century. I think if you button all the buttons on a suit jacket, you look insane. But also, you do you. Who are we to judge? James Conn said this could be a Tomb Raider. This game has a lot of similarities, I would say, to the modern Tomb Raider games and to the Last of Us games. Very much so. Also, Yasi, did you know this was developed by Asobo, who did the Microsoft Flight Simulator, which feels like a very different game?
Huh.
Both really, are very pretty.
Doing the whole spectrum, huh?
Yeah. Paul Size says, I think suits are a scam. Who's scam?
Looking nice isn't a scam.
Did you like being able to control the rats later on?
You seem to have so little opportunity to do it.
True. It did feel satisfying when my wave of rats would eat a man, though.
That's how they get you. That's how easily we lose our humanity.
There you go. And Simple Simon with a $69.69 donation.
That's
it's
a
the sex
one.
Number twice. Thank you so much, Simple Simon says. Of course, The Escapist is full of 40-somethings. Why do you think? Who do you think funds these goals? It's the 40-plus crowd with their disposable income and willingness to spend it on something stupid like making 69 jokes.
There you go.
I mean, I think that's the secret. Is you've been doing this for what, 15 years? You said.
Yep.
Making ZP. So I think people found you when they didn't have disposable income. But now those people have grown up and they have real jobs that aren't spoofing and goofing on the internet. And so they have disposable income. It's great.
So they can live vicariously with people whose job is to spoof and goof on the internet.
Yes, and get them to travel to such global hotspots as Milwaukee, which is a great city. I'm very excited. And I'm not even. Doesn't even involve me. I'm driving in my car an hour tomorrow.
You can show up if you want. We'll say hi.
I will say hi. There is no link. I tried to click the link. Well, first off, Honey Money deleted it too quickly. But there is no link in those sex messages.
You sound so disappointed.
I am, because I wanted to do journalism.
You wanted to do a sex journalism.
Ah. See, yeah, Honey Money says they can't post links. So what are they then? What do they do? I don't understand it.
They remind you of the concept of sex. So that you go and look at some porn, which might be theirs.
Okay. I feel like that's like a real shot in the dark that's going to be theirs, though. Because I think there's a lot of porno out there. Or so I've done research on my porno computer. You did great. Gotta stop talking about the porno computer. What's wrong? It's in their names. You have to highlight their name and then copy and then paste it into your URL.
People that's really like hot singles.
That's
they would
work.
Presumably feel motivated.
That's too much work. Scavenger with a $2 dono says, "Has your opinion of a game ever changed on stream?" Well, you've usually finished it by then, right?
Well, hopefully, yeah.
Yeah.
No, I don't think that's ever happened. I think when I was doing Soul Hackers, it was on stream that I tested out that the frame rate issue could remove one of the gameplay issues I had. That didn't really affect my overall opinion of the game.
You still didn't like it. That doesn't make the game better. That's true, Honey Money. Horny people have done less to quench their thirst. Dingus with a £5 dono, thank you so much, said, "This is a donation for Velcro shirts. Buttons are for boomers." I like Velcro shirts. There you go. Andrew Hickabottom with a £2 dono says, "Yahtzee, you can stay in Marty's cupboard and be tased." I would never. First off, my cupboard is very far away. Second off, I would never tase him. And the man who chopped off the finger with €5 dono, thank you so much, said, "What was it a couple minutes ago? A tag running circles around the village as a game mechanic? A literal gameplay loop?" I think it's nice.
Well, it's 3 o'clock, so I really want to stop the fuck out of this.
Well, it's a good thing that next week you're going to be playing a game that you really enjoy.
Well, I think I will enjoy taking the piss out of it more, because more people will agree with me.
Yes.
So, yes, that was A Plague Tale Requiem. If you would like to hear my full opinions, go and watch my Zero Punctuation review on escapismagazine.com or on YouTube if you're a YouTube member or Patreon subscriber.
Mm-hmm.
If you're neither of those things, you could always watch my Scorn review on YouTube, but that's old news, baby. I've got an extra punctuation dropping for members as well. There's never been a better time to become a YouTube member.
Ever. Never been a better time. Or a patron, if you will. Quite. That's what we call our patrons.
A patronus.
A patronus, yeah.
Is there a Harry Potter channel somewhere that calls its Patreon subscribers patronuses?
There's got to be.
If not, that's a drop ball. Do they have ball. Someone standing around who smacks them about the head with the flat of their hand whenever they do so? Because they should. Where are we? Oh, this close to 75%.
Excellent job, everybody.
Looks like you've disappointed me again.
You've made me very proud.
Well, we've only made 75% in like 20 days. I don't think we're going to make it. I've seen no reason to have any faith in our viewers.
I think you're all great. I think you're all great. I think you're all wonderful. I hope you all have an amazing rest of your evening. Also, in 1 hour from now, we're going to be back with Breakout, but this is like Theseus' ship of Breakout. Because Casey and Nick are both going to be gone, and so Frost and Jesse are going to be joining me. Is it even Breakout if two of the three hosts are gone? Tune in to find out.
Well, quite. Well, which host is the one that makes it Breakout?
I'm not saying it's me, but I'm the only one there tonight, so there you go. And then, no, Get Him to the Greek stream today, I believe. Because Casey's out. So no, Get Him to the Greek stream. And then tomorrow, Nick will be back. Nick and I will be back with Star Wars. We'll be finishing up, maybe, Jedi Outcast. Getting near the end of Jedi Outcast. And then no Metal Gear tomorrow, again, because Casey is out. And tomorrow, you're going to have the extra punctuation going out to... Is this a new one or going out to everybody?
It's a new one. Yeah, Silent Hill. Subscribers. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Addressing the Silent Hill announcement stream.
Yeah. It's called I Was Wrong, : Silent Hill 2 Remake is gonna be great.
That is exactly what it's called, and you should fully expect it to be called that.
Perfect.
Okay.
And then in terms of other streams, on Monday, aside from A Slave Something Else, we're going to be getting our, beginning our five-part Pulsar Lost Colony stream,
which our
patrons funded by hitting that goal. And so Yahtzee and I will be joined by Jack. That's going to be at 3:30 p.m. So it's going to be that time slot we've been, 3:30 Central, where the time slot we've been playing Elden Ring and various games in is going to be the three of us figuring out what Pulsar Lost Colony is.
I already installed it.
Get us some Pulsar codes. Oh, you already have it installed?
I installed Pulsar, and I fiddled about the tutorials, and I have no idea what the fuck you're supposed to do in it. Great. So it'll probably be fun to watch us muddle through that.
This sounds perfect. Nick, please give me a Pulsar code. Thank you. Goodbye, Nick.
I just paid for one with money.
Yeah, but you're going to expense it, right? That's not real money, is it?
I'm not sure I can be asked. I'll probably just write it off on my tax return. Okay, bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. Couldn't get to 75. Fuck you. Bye.